Iceland's former Prime Minister Geirharður says he's been made a scapegoat. A court has found him guilty of one of the four charges he faced for his handling of the 2008 banking crisis in his country. Does Harder's conviction set a precedent for other countries, and should politicians be criminally prosecuted for making wrong decisions? This is Inside Story. Hello, I'm Fully Batibo. Geirharður, the former Prime Minister of Iceland, has become the first politician to be found guilty over allegations that he didn't do enough to protect his country from the financial crisis. Mr. Harder was found guilty of one charge relating to the 2008 crisis that led to the collapse of all three of his country's major banks. But he was cleared of three more serious charges, including negligence. Barnaby Phillips reports.
Guilty of criminal negligence. Geirharður had argued the charges against him were absurd and politically motivated, that he could not have foreseen the global financial crisis. The judges, by and large, agreed, although they did find him guilty of a lesser charge, failing to inform ministers about the looming crash.
The court has made a grave mistake in reaching this conclusion, and I am therefore seriously considering whether to take this matter further to the European Court of Human Rights. I believe the majority of the judges have succumbed to political pressure in the case and decided to offer the prosecution a small consolation prize to partially justify this long and costly process.
Iceland's banks built up huge debts and then collapsed in a single week in 2008. It was traumatic. Many discovered that they were bankrupt, and they turned on the politicians. But could the kind of trial we've just seen in Iceland be replicated in other countries?
I think it would be a very popular move if politicians in Europe and the United States and elsewhere faced prosecution, but I think it's highly unlikely that we'll see this rolling out across other countries. I mean, there simply aren't the mechanisms there that there is, for instance, in Iceland to be able to prosecute a head of government for what is essentially a bad decision. It's not a criminal action in the usual sense of the word.
In Iceland, the anger endures. A slow recovery has begun, but even after today's verdict, many wonder why the people who led the banks have also not been put on trial. Barnaby Phillips, Al Jazeera.
So, should political leaders stand trial for mismanaging their country? To answer this question, we're joined by our guests. In New York, Sigrun Davidsdottir, an Icelandic financial journalist. Here in Doha, John Truby, professor at Qatar University and a specialist in business law. Also in Doha, James Moore. He's a former U.S. former assistant secretary of Commerce for Trade and Development during the Reagan administration. Thank you all for being on Inside Story. Now, before we begin the discussion, let's just take a listen, if we can, to what the Icelandic prime minister, the former prime minister, told Al Jazeera about his case.
The court is not a venue to settle political differences like what's being tried here, I mean, to do. If you have political differences, you solve them at the ballot box. And prosecuting political leaders for a crisis like this does not serve any purpose. There are so many, it's such a multifaceted thing when a banking crisis occurs that you cannot blame it on just one individual, not me in Iceland or other political leaders, by personally in other countries.
All right, Sigrun Davidsdottir, Geirharður says there that prosecuting leaders for the banking crisis doesn't serve a purpose. Do you agree with that? Does this case in Iceland set a precedent at all?
Well, I definitely think the way Iceland has dealt with the crisis set some sort of a precedence, because this case is just part of a wide-reaching process that came into being after the collapse. After the collapse, the feeling in Iceland was that there were plenty of things that were unclear. So what was set in motion was, first of all, to write an extensive report, which came out 2 years ago. Now, in this report, the the fingers were pointed at several ministers, not only Geir Horte, then the political process took over, and in the end, it was only he who stood trial. There are many people in Iceland who would think that there should have been more ministers on trial.
Just ministers.
But I don't think this is about...
And not just ministers. I was surprised to find out that, in fact, the bank leaders haven't been held accountable in this case.
No, but that process is ongoing, because what was also done in Iceland was to put up the office of a special prosecutor who is investigating all these matters. And that is now a big office, and they are actually investigating, and some bankers have been charged, and no doubt there will be other cases coming out. So this is sort of an extensive process that was set in motion in Iceland, not only to look at the politicians, but simply to clarify what had happened. So this is about clarification, accountability and responsibility. It's not about criminal charges at all.
Okay.
Clarification.
Let me bring in John Truby, if I can. John, this case, in a sense, is about how much responsibility politicians have for a banking system that they're supposed to regulate. But are the courts really the venue for this?
I must say I completely disagree with the former speaker. This was not just a case of bad economic policy. This was a case that has destroyed the Icelandic economy. It's led to a tripling in unemployment. It's led to a case where every Icelander born today owes the British government $22,000. Now, Icelandic law has failed to deal with this. What's happened on Monday was a whitewash. It has let the former Prime Minister off with some very serious charges for which Icelandic law was unable to cope with, because there was no regulatory framework, there was no sufficient criminal charge to bring him to account for.
But what was it really, should there have been a criminal charge in the first place? He's a politician, and he didn't embezzle any money as far as I know. So why bring a criminal charge against it?
If we can compare this to the corporate world, in the corporate world, directors owe a duty of care to their companies. They can go to prison, face criminal charges for things like breaches of environmental law, health and safety law, and other accounting law. Now, why can we not have a situation for the future which treats politicians who are in charge of economies far greater than the business world is in charge of for each company? Why can we not have a situation where politicians are held to account? If that is the case, they will be required to do what directors do, which is to take the required advice from specialists and to think more carefully before they take the risks that they're prepared to do.
All right, James Moore, he raises an interesting question there. John raises an interesting question. Should other European countries and the US also be holding politicians more responsible, more accountable? Wouldn't that make more sense than targeting the bankers who are just doing what they're paid to do? I mean, the politicians are paid to protect the citizens, aren't they?
I think the notion of somehow giving the bankers a blank check on all this, I think, is wrong. And to somehow target just the politicians, I think, is wrong. I think that the crisis in Iceland was really a factor of the fact that there were riverboat gamblers over a period of years who engaged in some really high-risk practices. The notion that three banks would have accumulated a debt that was six times the gross domestic product of Iceland is an awful, awful situation. But this was really a collective situation in which both politicians and the bankers really were trying to give the Icelandic economy a lift, really believing that their high-stake gambles were going to pay at the end of the day. Of course, we know that they didn't. I mean, one of the things that I think is important to realize that at the time that this country of 320,000 people failed was just at the same time time that Lehman Brothers was essentially collapsing as well. Mm. Richard Fuld, to my knowledge, is still very much out on the street. So the notion that somehow that you criminally prosecute the Prime Minister of Iceland in the midst of all this, I think we've learned lots and lots of lessons. I think, quite frankly, that this period of time in our history, namely for Iceland around 2006, 2007 to about 2009, I think lessons have been learned, and there certainly are things being put into place to make sure that this sort of thing cannot happen in the future.
But James, this would be a popular move in the U.S. if politicians were also facing prosecution for their actions. I mean, not just the bankers on Wall Street. I'm sure a lot of Americans would like to see politicians also be held accountable. Wouldn't you agree?
Well, yeah, absolutely. But when you have a House of Representatives in which people are up every 2 years, certainly people are going to be able to vote them in or out. The notion that somehow for decisions that are made that are not criminal in the sense of conspiracy or corruption or whatever, in which people are trying to essentially make decisions based on the facts that they have, the notion that you somehow can criminally prosecute them, I think, is way off base.
All right, Sigron, if I can get back to you, you know this case very well. So a guilty verdict for the former prime minister of a lesser charge of basically failing to inform politicians and ministers about the looming crisis, and yet no punishment. So it's very difficult to comprehend. What sort of punishment should he have received, in your opinion?
Well, in the ruling, it's pointed out that he is 61 years old and obviously has not done anything before of any, you know, criminal activity. So he is acquitted in the sense that, you know, there is no punishment. But it's been pointed out in Iceland by leading legal experts, but that this is not a lightweight sentence. This is a sentence, and I don't agree with the previous speaker who said that this was a whitewash. It isn't. And I think that the reaction of the prime minister or the former prime minister after the ruling showed that this is not a whitewash. This is a serious thing. Now, it should also be pointed out that in Iceland, it's not just that Iceland is going after politicians. They are going after the bankers.
But no banker has been charged yet. No banker has been put to trial yet in Iceland.
There have been... Yes, there are ongoing trials in Iceland regarding bankers. So, the office of the special prosecutor has actually charged some bankers, and there are definitely more cases coming. This is not a finished case in Iceland, so Iceland is really investigating this. And I think countries like Ireland, like Greece, like Spain, like Italy, Portugal, I mean, all these countries, I'm sure, would do well in looking at what is happening in their countries. So I'm not saying that Iceland is some sort of a leading example here, but it's interesting that Iceland has actually done a lot. But you should also keep in mind that the reason why the Icelandic banks could grow as they did was because they were cooperating with other leading international banks. So this was not something that was created in Iceland, and it's quite correct that, you know, you have to see this in a wider context. And the banks could finance themselves because they were lending from other leading banks. And that's quite interesting. Wow. Now that what we are seeing in Iceland in the Icelandic banks is, alleged fraud, and these banks were cooperating with other international banks.
Well, Geir Harder is the first world leader, as we've been saying, to face criminal charges over the global financial meltdown, but he's not the first to face public anger. Protests fueled by economic hardship have brought down many leaders. Ireland was the first country in the Eurozone to enter recession, as declared by the Central Statistics Office in 2008. And in 2009, 326,000 people claimed unemployment. The Fianna Fáil Green Party coalition collapsed within months. Italy's economic woes toppled Prime Minister Silvio Berlusconi in November. Italy, the third largest economy in the Eurozone, has a public debt more than that of Greece, Ireland and Spain all combined. In November, Spanish voters dealt a blow to the Socialist Party over their perceived mishandling of the crisis. The Spanish economy has entered a double-dip recession and its current employment rate is at 22%. So, John Truby, What is happening in Iceland isn't a criminal action in the usual sense of the word. Could this kind of case that we've seen happen in Iceland be replicated in other countries? Are there mechanisms in place in a country like Greece, for instance, for a government, a head of government, to be held responsible for the financial crisis?
Unfortunately, the current situation is that most prime ministers are protected by ministerial immunity while their life of parliament exists. And in Greece, the situation is that because Papandreou's parliament broke and was dissolved, he is now exempt. He has now immunity continuing, and he will never be able to be brought to account for this. What we need to think is for the future. We never had the situation, the legal consequences for politicians to face. Now, politicians around the world were able to raise hundreds of billions of dollars in debt for their country for short-term economic gain during the boom years, and they certainly had political popularity because of this. They gained themselves during their time, but they were not thinking about the sustainability of the future. Why should politicians be allowed to bankrupt a country in the future? Why should they be allowed to take a situation to borrow so much money that a country can never pay it off so that it's popular now, but it will be damaging for a future government? There should be some limits, first of all, some caps on how much any government can borrow during normal years of growth or stability. And there should be some accountability for ministers and prime ministers who go beyond this. Now, in the case of Iceland, yes, the situation is that in Kaupthing Bank, the CEO and the chairman are facing trial because of fraud and other charges. But with the prime minister, the former prime minister, I think we should be saying that the buck stops with him. In a company, the CEO would be facing charges. With the prime minister, he saw a period, he enjoyed his political popularity during that period, and he should now be facing the charges. He should
James
be held accountable.
If I could bring in James Moore. James, do you think a country like the United States is likely to revisit its laws to make sure that politicians that mismanage the country, the economy, also face criminal charges?
The short answer is no. Again, you know, we're talking here about democracy. We're talking about being able to face off with the American people. Make no mistake, there are a number of mechanisms that are in place in the United States to be able to deal with some of this. There is no question that there has been profligate spending, I think, in just the past few years. But I think that the tale of Iceland, as well as others, is really going to be also a matter of globalization. The fact that we just cannot talk about what's happening from one country to the next country and the disastrous implications in that country alone. The fact remains is that the kinds of economic ills that we're talking about in Iceland, as well as throughout parts of Europe, the fact remains is that it has a rippling effect with other countries. And so it is incumbent upon a number of organizations like the International Monetary Fund to be able to deal with this collectively, not just one over the other, because at the end of the day, when you have the likes of what happened in Iceland, but also compounded with the collapse of one of the great houses of all times, namely Lehman Brothers, you clearly have an intersection that has got to be dealt with by governments and not just individual governments one at a time.
But if there are tougher laws, it would serve as a deterrent, won't you agree? It would make the leaders think hard before they take any financial decision very lightly.
I'm not sure we're talking about laws in the sense that individuals are culpable by themselves for certain things. I think what has to be put in is a regime, a regimen of being able to say you can spend this much and you've got to be able ultimately to have the income of that much, so that you are trying to balance your books, that you are not passing on to the next generation an onerous debt. But the notion of putting together laws on the book that you're somehow criminally going to go after politicians or others when they have used their best judgment to be able to do certain things, I think, is really an exercise in a moot debate.
Sigrun, do you agree with that? That, you know, putting laws and it would only pile the pressure on politicians and wouldn't be productive. Do you agree with that?
I'm not quite sure I agree, because this is not just about haunting people down. This is also, as I said before, it's a process of clarification. And the whole thing that's happened in Iceland has been sort of aimed at that, just finding out what happened and the decisions that were taken. You know, the collapse of three main banks in one day. This is not a natural catastrophe. This is not an earthquake or a volcanic eruption. This is the end of a process where wrong decisions were taken all along. So it's so important, I think. And you know, if you're going to learn anything from this, it's to clarify what happened. And this legal process is only part of that. As I said, there was a report that came out, and so on. So I think that, you know, people in Ireland, people in the other indebted European states, and in the US, you know, people would like to know what exactly happened. And that's been, you know, that's been the aim of the process in Iceland, really, to answer these questions.
John Truby, once, you know, we know what really happened, and, you know, once it's decided that leaders were indeed responsible to some aspect for the financial crisis, what should happen, in your opinion?
For the future, going forward, we need a much stricter regulatory framework for banks to operate within. The banks in Iceland were operating within the framework, albeit with very limited supervision. They need to be supervised. There needs to be much stricter regulation. Furthermore, we need in countries to adopt some sort of accountability for ministers. It's not enough to say that the punishment for making bad decisions is losing an election. There needs to be more than that.
Yeah, but by piling on the pressure of potential punishment might make politicians less decisive and less inclined to push forward legislations. Wouldn't you agree?
And possibly rightly so. They need to be prepared to take certain risks, but they need the full advice from those risks. They need to consult professionals. They need to be very certain and not speculative of the risks they're taking, because they're not just dealing with a small country, and they're not just dealing with economic theory, they're dealing with people's lives. This has really affected so many lives. Millions of people unemployed around the world, thousands in Iceland. And it's not enough to say that politicians can just lose an election and walk away.
James Moore, can the economic crisis draw governments into new levels of engagement?
Well, absolutely, and that's exactly what's happening with the International Monetary Fund right now. I mean, you know, let's face it. We have just gone through one of the most extraordinary periods in economic history. We're all referring to it as the Great Recession. We're still trying to come out of it. The economy in the United States is anemic in coming into a recovery. In Europe, Europe is flat on its back. We have just had here in Doha, Qatar, the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development, which has tried to give some kind of form to what exactly has been happening between the developing and the developed world. But the fact remains is that we are not going to lose consciousness of what we've just gone through, because governments and peoples are not going to want to go through this again. And so there have been regulations that have been put into place. They've certainly been put into place in the United States, and they're being put to place in Europe right now. And so the notion that we somehow are going to focus on criminal actions against politicians while really trying to get to the systemic problem that exists and needs to be addressed, and that means things like regulatory regimes, so that we're talking not just about specific single individual countries, rather we're talking about those countries and the global community and being able to deal with the problem.
Realistically, will these regulations that you talk about, will they be effective in the long run? And can we really apply them to every country, to European countries as well as the American countries?
Well, clearly, each country is going to have to tackle this in its own way. But in the United States, there have been a number of laws that have been put into practice in dealing with things like ethical corruption in business, as well as the recent problems that we've had in being able to chalk up the debt. The fact remains is that there is a need to be more aggressive in being able to deal with the banking sector, the financial sector, and in turn to be able to understand what is happening in other global markets, to be able to see that we're not looking at negative growth rates in places like Italy and Spain and Portugal and Ireland, and that we, in fact, have been able to get a grasp of what it is that the economy needs, and to make sure that we don't have these riverboat gamblers that effectively are ruining these economies.
Okay, thank you very much indeed for speaking to us. James Moore there in Doha. Thank you to all of our guests joining us today on this edition of Inside Stories. Sigron, David Stotir in New York, in Doha, John Truby, and as I mentioned, James Moore. Thank you all for taking part in this debate. And thank you so much as well for joining us on this edition of Inside Story. As always, if you want to send us your feedback, just email us your thoughts at insidestory@aljazeera.net. Thanks for watching.